الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الحديث هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة. Some things in the Quran are more important than others. This is not a controversial statement. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Yusuf, he calls the story of Yusuf Ahsan al-Qasas, the best of stories. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Ayat al-Kursi is the best ayah in the Quran. He also, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said that Surah Al-Ikhlas is equivalent to one-third of the Qur'an. Some parts of the Qur'an are more important than others, even if all of them are important. You can also usually tell how important something is by how much it is mentioned. Tawheed. Our belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one, unique, indivisible, is everywhere in the Quran. Before, during, and after every story and parable. The story of Musa, alayhi salam, is one of the most frequent stories in the Quran. It is found in many, many chapters, including the second chapter, al-Baqarah, the 7th chapter, Al-A'raf, and the 28th chapter, Al-Qasas. This week we will be looking at the story of Musa, alayhi salam, as told in the 28th chapter, Al-Qasas. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, نَزْلُ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ نَبَئِ مُوسَى وَفِرْعَوْنَ بِالْحَقِّ لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. We narrate to you, O Prophet, part of the story of Moses and Pharaoh in truth for people who believe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he uses the word naba instead of khabar, instead of qisa, because the word naba is only used for important news. Who is this important news for? For people who believe. Allah is not just telling us stories as entertainment. Our education as believers depends upon these stories. Communities of believers like ours have come and have gone. Many of them lost their way. Many of them bartered away the guidance they were given for material gain. Many proved ungrateful. The list goes on and on. Allah Ta'ala recounts these stories to us here in Utica 2021, not to make us feel better than them, but to show us the mistakes they made, so that we may avoid those mistakes and realize the gravity of our responsibility as people of faith. Allah then says, إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَىٰ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَجَعْلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِّنْهُمْ يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Indeed, Pharaoh arrogantly elevated himself in the land and divided up its people into groups, one group of which he persecuted by slaughtering their sons and allowing to live their daughters. He was truly one of the corrupt. In listing the sins of Pharaoh, Allah Ta'ala begins with arrogance. Ala bilaf. Arrogance, as we mentioned last week, makes duty, service, and worship completely impossible. It ruins everything. And we see this quality personified in the figure of Fir'aun. His second sin is to divide society into groups and oppress some of those groups based on their group identity. The people of faith, the Israelites, Bani Israel, were living in constant fear of the ruling class. They were arbitrarily killed, particularly their sons. They were enslaved with no opportunity of economic or social advancement. The reason for this, as Ibn Kathir says in his tafsir, is that the chiefs of Pharaoh's people were aware of something that Ibrahim had said long ago to his son Ishaq. What he said to him was that he would have descendants. Descendants would come from him, one of whom would end up destroying Pharaoh. They feared losing their power, and so they used every means at their disposal to try to avoid this prophecy. Then Allah Ta'ala says, وَنُرِيدُ أَن نَمُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَنَجْعَلَهُمُ الْأَئِمَّةَ وَنَجْعَلَهُمُ الْوَارِثِينَ وَنُمَكِّنَ لَهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَنُرِيَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا مِنْهُم مَّا كَانُوا يَحْذَرُونَ. But it was our will to favor those who were oppressed in the land and making them the leaders and the inheritors, and to establish them in the land and through them to show Pharaoh and Haman and their soldiers the fulfillment of exactly what they had feared. Allah Ta'ala outlines what he will do in response to Pharaoh's corruption. He says matter-of-factly that he will favor those who were oppressed and reverse their fortunes, making the weak strong and making the enslaved leaders. The oppressed will remain after to inherit and succeed their oppressors. This is the very thing the oppressors feared would happen. Despite their illusion of power and control, the exact path that they took to solidify their grasp on power would end up being the very thing that brought them to ruin. Allah Ta'ala only allows oppressors to get so far before he snatches them up in revenge. Allah is al-Muntaqim, the Avenger. And the fact that he gives oppressors time and the opportunity to give up their wrongdoing should not be misunderstood as an injustice. Allah Ta'ala extends the same opportunity to everyone and gives the oppressed an opportunity as well to develop virtue and to secure their salvation because of what they suffer. وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَضْلِعِيهِ فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَمِّ وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي إِنَّا رَادُّوهُ إِلَيْكِ وَجَاعِلُوهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. We inspired the mother of Moses, nurse him, but when you fear for him, put him into the river, and do not fear, nor grieve. We will certainly return him to you and make him one of the messengers. The mother of Moses, alayhi salam, is asked to make an extraordinary leap of faith. She knows that if Pharaoh finds baby Moses, he will kill him. In normal circumstances, keeping your baby with you would give the child a much better chance of survival than sending off the child down a river by themselves. But because the mother of Moses, alayhi salam, believes in her heart that Allah Ta'ala is more capable of protecting her child than the everyday causes of protection and safety that Allah Himself created, she obeys. Allah is the creator of those causes, and so He can easily intervene and bring about safety from what would normally be the most threatening situation. A fire can become cool, just like Ibrahim alayhi salam. In this story, sending your child down the river by themselves is safer by the will of Allah than keeping them close by your side. Allah Ta'ala doesn't tell the mother of Moses that it's even worse than what she knows, that Moses is going to be promptly delivered to their sworn enemy, Pharaoh. Maybe it would have been too much for her if she had known Allah knows best. But even given what she knows, very difficult choice that no mother ever wants to have to make. She relies upon Allah and passes the test. And it so happened that Pharaoh's people picked up the baby Moses only for him to become their enemy and source of grief. Surely Pharaoh, Haman, and their soldiers were sinful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Latif. He is the most subtle. By the power and knowledge of Allah, a fire can become refreshing and cool. The oppressor can become a protector. And an innocent baby can cause the downfall of a mighty dynasty. وَقَالَ تِلْمَاتُ فِرْعَوْنَ قُرَّةُ عَيْنٍ لِي وَلَكْ لَا تَقْتُلُوهُ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعْنَا أَوْ نَتَّخِذَهُ وَلَدًا وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Pharaoh's wife said to Pharaoh, "This baby is a source of joy for me, and you don't kill him. Perhaps he may be useful to us, or we may adopt him as a son." They were unaware of what was going to come. Allah Ta'ala, He controls the entire creation, even hearts of the people. He is muqallib al-qulub, as the Prophet used to say in his dua. In this story, Allah Ta'ala softens the hearts of Fir'aun and his wife Asiya toward baby Musa, who could have been an Israelite, they don't know. Which explains why Pharaoh's wife tells him not to kill the baby. Even though he was gripped with fear and paranoia and the delusion of control, Allah Ta'ala softened his heart to accept Moses into his household. وَأَصْبَحَ فُؤَادُ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ فَارِغًا إِنْ كَادَتْ لَتُبْدِي بِهِ لَوْلَا أَنْ رَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قَلْبِهَا لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And the heart of Moses' mother ached so much that she almost gave away his identity. Had we not reassured her heart, in order for her to have faith in Allah's promise, Just as Allah softened the hearts of Pharaoh towards Moses, He strengthened the aching hearts of Moses' mother. The mother of Moses, alayhi salam, is expressing a need that every single one of us has. When we suffer, when we go through hardship, we need to share this hardship with someone. We go looking for encouragement and understanding from those who we trust. This is not an impious act. This is not complaining. Allah is al-Hadi, the guide. And part of the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides us is by placing in our paths mentors and good friends who give us sound advice. Asking for advice, guess what? It means you're going to reveal your difficulties to other people. This need is so strong in the mother of Musa alayhi salam that she almost blows her cover. If she had told anyone that she was missing a child, people might connect the dots and realize that with certainty the child that Pharaoh was raising in his own household was in fact one of the Israelites. This would have changed Pharaoh's attitude towards him and put Moses in grave danger. وقال لأخته قصيه فبصرت به عن جنب وهم لا يشعرون. And she said to his sister, the mother of Moses said to Moses' sister, keep track of him. So she watched him from a distance while they were unaware. We learn here in this verse, as we do in so many others, that tawakkul, reliance upon Allah Ta'ala, is not a passive activity. It's not sitting back and doing nothing. No, it is relying upon Allah Ta'ala while you act and give your best effort. Just like the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and the companions at the Battle of the Trench. They dug the trench and then relied upon Allah. Here the mother of Moses alayhi salam relies on Allah and stifles her grief, at least in public. But then she sends her daughter to see what's going on. وَحَرَّمْنَا عَلَيْهِ الْمَرَاضِعَ مِنْ قَبْلُ فَقَالَتْ هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِ بَيْتٍ يَكْفُلُونَهُ لَكُمْ وَهُمْ لَهُ نَاصِحُونَ. And we caused him to refuse, talking about Moses, refuse all the women who tried to nurse him at first. So his sister then suggested, shall I direct you to a family who will bring him up for you and take good care of him? Allah is al-Aqim. He is the subtle. He has already prepared the way for Moses' sister to have this unique opportunity. Just as he caused hearts to soften toward Moses, alayhi salam, he caused Moses to refuse all attempts at nursing him. And if you've been around enough hungry babies, you can imagine the kind of distress that this caused Pharaoh and his wife Asiya. Moses' sister immediately seizes the opportunity and presents herself as someone who can find a solution to this problem, cleverly concealing her identity. فَرَدَدَنَاهُ إِلَىٰ أُمِّهِ كَيْ تَقَرَّ عَيْنُهَا وَلَا تَحْزَنَ وَلِتَعْلَمَ أَنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ ولكن أكثرهم لا يعلمون. This is how he returned him to his mother, so that her heart would be put at ease and not grieve, and that she would know that Allah's promise subhanahu wa ta'ala is always true, but most people know not. Allah Ta'ala is the most merciful of Rahman. He doesn't want to see the people of faith in pain, in grief. He has complete goodwill towards them and wants the absolute best for them. But more than happiness, more than the beautiful things of this life, such as children and prosperity, Allah wants us to know that His promise is true. Not just the promise Allah made to reunite Moses with his mother, but His promise of justice, His promise of paradise, His promise of eternal life, that He has made to the people of faith. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين في كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. إحساني وشكر له على توفيقه وامتناني وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له تعظيما لشأني وأشهد أن نبينا وسيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى رضوانه صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وإخوانه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Next, Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَمَّا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ وَاسْتَوَى آتَيْنَاهُ حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And when he, meaning Musa alayhi salam, reached full strength and maturity, we gave him wisdom and knowledge. This is how we reward the doers of good. Then Allah says that one day, he entered the city unnoticed by its people. There, Moses, he found two men that were fighting. One of those two people was from his own group, and the other was from his enemies, the people of Pharaoh, the ruling class. The man from his people called out to Moses for help against his enemy. So Musa, alayhi salam, struck him, causing his death. Musa, alayhi salam, cried, "This is the work of the devil. He is certainly a sworn, misleading enemy." Moses, alayhi salam, is drawn into a fight based off of his identity. He sees someone he identifies with in this fight. So he enters into the fight not as a peacemaker, not as someone trying to establish Allah's justice, but as a partisan, as someone who is biased to the group he belongs to. This is the opposite of Allah's justice that he calls to in the Quran. The justice that is applied equally to everyone, regardless of creed, regardless of tribe, regardless of status. Justice that isn't reactionary. Justice that relies on fact-finding and verifying what's really going on before rushing into things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us a very important lesson about priorities. There's nothing wrong with being part of a group or feeling a strong sense of group identity or solidarity. In fact, an essential part of our faith is having allegiance to the Muslims, both locally and over the globe. But that allegiance is conditional and subordinate to Allah's command. Our supreme allegiance is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone even from our group comes along and tries to appeal to our common group identity and to our allegiance to each other and leverage that to get us to violate one of Allah's commands, that's where we stop. No one is exempt from Allah's law, no matter what group they are part of. Musa alayhi salam makes an honest mistake here. And he immediately regrets it. He also immediately recognizes the role that the devil played in this situation. The devil is always there to fan the flames that lead to conflict, and then, once it's over, rationalize the mistakes that we've made. If you or I were in Moses' situation, the devil would have been there as well to help us recall every single wrong that other group did to us. And then after our mistake, he would suggest every reason why we were justified to behave the way that we did. Musa alayhi salam, he sees right through it and repents, saying, "Qala rabbi inni zalamtu nafsi faghfir li faghfar lahu innahu huwa al-ghafur rahim." He pleaded, "My Lord, I have definitely wronged my soul, so forgive me." So Allah forgave him, for he is indeed the all-forgiving and the most merciful. Musa, alayhi salam, he has true understanding. He not only knows that he was at fault, he knows that the biggest oppression committed wasn't against anybody else, but himself. Allah knows that the repentance of Musa is sincere, and so he accepts it. This should not surprise us. The Prophet said that if we approached Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely, even if we had enough sin to fill the heavens and the earth, Allah would still forgive us if we you're truly repentant. Then Allah says, قَالَ رَبِّي بِمَا أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيَّ فَلَنْ أَكُونَ ظَهِيرًا لِلْمُجْرِمِينَ. Moses then pledged. He said, my Lord, for all of your favors upon me, I will never side with the wicked. Musa alayhi salam has two powerful key ingredients to sincere repentance that we can learn from. First, he is grateful. He recognizes the favors of Allah Ta'ala upon him, even the ability to come to Allah in repentance is a blessing we are indebted to Allah for. Our indebtedness to Allah Ta'ala establishes the obligation to obey Allah and admit when we have fallen short. This is the internal dimension of genuine repentance. Second is to make a resolution to change. Would anyone accept an apology from someone who didn't show any resolve to change their behavior? Imagine someone used foul, insulting language with you and then apologized for it. You accept their apology, but on the very next day, they're back at it, insulting you once again. You would tell yourself, this person is not actually sorry. Their apology was fake. If we want to prove our sincerity when we repent to Allah Ta'ala, we have to at least resolve to change our ways, even if we end up falling back into old habits by mistake. This is the external dimension of tawbah, of repentance. يَتَرَكَّبُ فَإِذَا الَّذِي اسْتُضْعِفُوا فَإِذَا الَّذِي اسْتَنْصَرَهُ بِالْأَمْسِ يَسْتَصْرِحُ قَالَ لَهُ مُوسَى إِنَّكَ لَغَوِيٌّ مُبِينٌ. And so Moses became fearful, watching out in the city, when suddenly the one who sought his help the day before cried out to him yet again for help. Moses now rebuked him. Indeed, you are clearly a troublemaker. Moses alayhi salam has learned his lesson. He knows that he can't take everyone at their word. He can't take every situation at face value. Justice demands fact-checking. Justice demands verification. The truth has to be uncovered. He notices a pattern of behavior with this man and refuses to be led astray by prejudice twice. Allah then says, then when he was about to lay his hands on their foe, the enemy said, oh Moses, you intend to kill me just as you killed someone yesterday. You only want to be a tyrant in the land. You do not intend to make peace at all. Word has spread about what happened to Moses, and Moses' fears are proven true. It is no longer safe for him to stay in the city. وَجَاءَ رَجُلٌ مِّنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ يسعى قال يا موسى إن الملأ يأتمرون بك ليقتلوك فاخرج إني لك من الناصحين. And there came a man rushing from the furthest end of the city. He said, oh Moses, the chiefs are conspiring against you to put you to death. So leave immediately. I sincerely advise you to do so. There must have been unease among the chiefs of the city about Moses, alayhi salam, who was an Israelite raised in the house of Pharaoh. Their suspicions about him must have worsened as he grew up. This was their perfect excuse to get rid of him. In a society that was just, this would have been treated for the accidental death that it was, but in Pharaoh's society, this was a case where members of the slave class killed someone from the ruling class. Justice would not be done, rather an example would be made out of Musa. فخرج منها خائفا يترقب قال ربي نجني من القوم الظالمين. So Moses alayhi salam left the city in a state of fear and caution, praying, my Lord, deliver me from the wrongdoing people. Musa alayhi salam must now make a similar leap of faith, just like his mother did so many years ago. He has to leave the only home that he has known and go into exile, fearing for his own life, always looking over his shoulder to see if he is being hunted down. But, as we've seen, Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He turns what we experience as our biggest hardship and setback into our biggest blessing and period of growth. Musa alayhi salam has no idea where he'll go or what he'll do, but he's not being asked to know or to have it all figured out. All he's being asked to do is trust Allah ta'ala, the one who has protected him and guided him every step of the way so far. As long as your relationship with Allah ta'ala is strong and you put forward effort, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of the results. صلوا وسلموا على نبي رحمة كما أمركم ربكم حيث قال إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم ارحم موتانا واعف مبتلانا واشف مرضانا واهد ضالنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه يا عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله يذكركم والله يعلم ما تصنعون